People in the West ask me why it's like that, and I say it's cause I got the right to fight back. Used to be a big believer in diplomacy, till I was staring down the barrel of your goals for me.
Initial invasion, because I was in Baghdad. On the day that Baghdad fell, in April 9th of 2003, people were saying Baghdad fell in 21 days. But many Iraqis and people who were living in Iraq, like myself, were saying Baghdad fell in 13 years. We were living under sanctions and bombings and continuous foreign intervention for 13 years. So when we speak about the U.S. intervention in Iraq, I think we should look at it on the bigger picture. The initial invasion was called by the international mainstream media civilian-friendly. They were saying this invasion was conducted by smart bombs that just killed the bad guys. Now, because I was in Iraq and I witnessed what the invasion looked like, I knew that many civilians were killed, and that's why I started working with other Iraqi volunteers to document the actual names and the details of every Iraqi civilian who was killed during the initial invasion, just the first few weeks. Now, the initial idea was that we were trying to put faces and names on Iraqi casualties, because usually the Iraqi side has this number, more or less. Now we stand on, it's between 100,000 and 1,000,000. No one knows how much the number is. So the idea was not to just reach to a figure, was actually to go door to door and put people's names and pictures and details, to put this human face. My personal experience taught me that you can never put a human face on casualties. Each one of these casualties, they need years and years and years of description to speak about their life and the loss that their loved ones are living. You can't put the noise of explosions in the casualties list. You can't put the voice of moms crying on casualties lists. You can't put the faces of children who are missing their parents on casualties lists. I mean, it was such a disaster to see how big of a pain one person killed can cause, let alone 100,000 or 1,000,000. Is types of weapons that were used in the war. Many people refer to a number of weapons as illegal weapons, like the depleted uranium bullets or the nail bombs. And I saw these things, like witnessed them with my first-hand experience. There was a place in Nasiriyah, a city in the south of Iraq, where the U.S. dropped nail bombs inside a residential neighborhood. The thing that I remember is that I went there with some of the volunteers to document casualties. And the neighborhood looked like science fiction. There were these entire walls with tens of thousands of small nails dug into them. Just stand and look at these tens of thousands of little black nails that are 1 inch long with little wings. Of course, I saw a couple of civilians who said we lost our loved ones, and one person who lost his toes. He actually showed me the nail that hit his foot. And there are many other weapons that were used that are usually called illegal. But for someone like myself and my family and the other millions of Iraqis who were harmed by this occupation, there is no such a thing as a legal weapon. Every bullet that was fired in this illegal war is an illegal weapon. It's not like Iraqis were like, okay, if you want to kill us by bullets, it's fine. But by DU, no, that's illegal. The amount of people who were killed and injured is unexplainable. I can't explain it. I can't explain the pain that I have, and I haven't lost my direct family members. So imagine now where we stand after 5 years of this war, where 1 million Iraqis were killed because of violent death. 1 million. And another 4.5 or 5 million are displaced. They lost their homes. But what's more important is to stop more killing. It's more important to try to stop the continuous bleeding of the country and the continuous attacks that are happening. There are two narratives now in the world. One narrative is mostly in the English language in the US of what is the way to deal with the war, and the other is in Arabic, usually in Iraq. The US narrative is that the war is happening in Iraq because Iraqis are crazy Muslims who are killing each other. They have been killing each other for thousands of years. And they blow up themselves because they have different DNA, just like more viable for violence. And we can't pull out from Iraq, not because we want to occupy them and like steal their wealth. No, because we like them. What the majority of Iraqis are saying, they are saying, we have a foreign intervention, a foreign occupation that is destroying the country, and that is putting Iraqis against each other, not because of ancient hatred based on religious differences. It's putting Iraqis against each other based on their political and economic agendas. So now, when we understand this narrative, we will understand that a U.S. occupation will not cause the sky to fall and Sunnis and Shiites to eat each other in the streets. A U.S. occupation will be the first and key step for the reconstruction and reconciliation process to start. It's not the final step. It's not like after the last U.S. soldier leaves, Iraq will turn into heaven on earth. But it's the first step. There are other thousands of steps pending, waiting for the day that the last U.S. soldier, the last U.S. contractor, the last U.S. base is closed, so that Iraqis can start the process of rebuilding their country and reconciling. Now, this is exactly the opposite of what the Bush administration and the mainstream politicians are saying in the U.S. Iraqis like myself voted for the parliament, and the parliament have asked the U.S. to leave Iraq. The parliament has passed a resolution saying, get out of Iraq. Set a timetable for a complete withdrawal that leaves no permanent bases, no contractors, and no troops. But we never hear this voice. We never hear this voice. We never hear the voices of the elected Iraqi officials. We just hear the voices of the Sunnis and Shiites and Kurds who are allied with the Bush administration. The little puppets who are hiding in the green zone, who were not elected, and who are saying, please stay to liberate us. We love you to stay here. This is what we want you to be there. Well, the last time I checked, when you step on someone's foot in the bus, first you remove your foot, then you apologize. The takeaway point is that the majority of the Iraqi public, whether they were Sunnis or Shiites or Kurds, the majority of the Iraqi elected officials, whether they were Sunnis or Shiites or Kurds, are demanding to end all types of U.S. intervention completely. No political intervention, no economic intervention, no military bases there, no one there to babysit us or to protect us from our neighbors and cousins. No one. Just leave Iraq alone. This is the message. Leave Iraq alone to the Iraqis.